Hello, welcome to EPR with your favorite podcast nerds, Nic and Laura. On today's episode, we will talk about shoutouts. And this episode is a little bit about birds. Nic and I talk about some birds and the joy of finding your place in the scientific community. And then we interview Rona Spellacy to discuss her role in NAEP, her level of travel and food, and the intersection of conservation and construction. Be sure to subscribe, rate, and review. Hit that music.
Today, I want to give a shout out to Patrick Solomon. I mentioned in the last episode that I had a mentor, a NEPA mentor, when I first started in the industry. And I didn't say his name. That's totally on me. But yeah, Patrick, if you're listening, thank you so much for teaching me so much about NEPA and how the regulate environmental policy world works. If you guys have promotions, new jobs, professional or project awards that you want to share with us, please let us know. We'd love to highlight you at the beginning of the show. So send those in to environmentalprofessionalsradio.com. Also, don't forget to check out the latest news in the NAEP National Desk newsletter, available at naep.org. One more thing I'll let you know about. Don't forget to check your local chapters for awards your projects could win or for scholarship opportunities. You know, those are great resources for us. And sometimes we just need a healthy reminder. So just go check them out. Talk to your local reps. See if there's a place for you to get some recognition.
All right, before we get to the show, let's please thank our sponsor, AKRF. They're a multidisciplinary consulting firm specializing in environmental planning and engineering services. They serve their clients through a commitment to technical excellence across a portfolio of professional services while always acting with integrity and fostering a culture of innovation, collaboration, and environmental stewardship. AKRF is committed to promoting diversity and inclusion in their workplace. You can check them out at akrf.com. If you'd like to sponsor a future episode yourself, head on over to environmentalprofessionalsradio.com and fill out the sponsor inquiry form.
So Laura tricked me last episode, and she knows one of my party tricks is doing impressions, and she knows that I can do Arnold Schwarzenegger. And to be fair, to really do that impression, you gotta go all out, you gotta be all in. And I wasn't. I didn't want you guys to know that, because I know that no matter how many times I tell you not to ask me to do it, whenever you do see me again, it's gonna happen. I get it.
Yeah, it was disappointing. I wanted more from that.
I know you did. So I'm gonna do it one time here. I'm gonna do the Predator scene. We'll never bring it up again. You guys won't remember, and you'll never ask me in person, right? I'm sure that's what's going to happen. So here we go. This is Arnold Schwarzenegger in The Predator, all right? Go! Run! Get to the chopper! If it bleeds, we can kill it. There you go. That's it. That's all I'm doing. And never again. We'll never again do it. But I do love
it. I'm going to ask you all the time.
I know. You.
Oh, it never gets old.
It's just, yeah. My favorite one, it really is. If it bleeds, we can kill it. It just, I don't know why, but it just, I say that all the time to my wife. She's like, what's wrong with you? I'm like, I have no idea. You know, so there you go. I did it. I did it the one time. That's it.
I mean, my favorite is still, it's not a tumor. It's just.
Yeah. It's not a tumor. Yeah. Who is your daddy and what does he do? Yeah. Kindergarten cop. And that's just, oh man, just amazing.
No way. Jingle all the way.
Sinbad, man. Oh man. All right, that takes it back.
This is EPR.
Are you a bird person? Do you like birds?
I'm not like, you know, wild about birds. I'm not a birder. I don't need to go find the rarest and the most unique. You know, I actually feel bad when they're like, oh, that's a super rare bird. I'm like, okay, thank you for, I guess I see it over there. It's neat. And I know it's just a really fascinating and fun thing. It's just not my thing, unfortunately. So
yeah.
I don't know. Do you?
I want to be like, I love seeing a bird species I haven't seen, but you know, my memory issue is a limitation.
right.
Because like you've said about your wife, I could have seen a bird 100 times before and I'm like, oh, I've never seen that one before.
right. Yeah. Well,
so yeah. I do love it. I love to travel. when we went to Africa, there was pretty much two different factions. One that was adamantly pro bird watching, and they would take, it was either bird watching truck or you were in the truck, and you had to make sure you were on the right one. Otherwise your entire day was dictated differently.
Right.
I kind of really didn't mind which one I got into. The birder truck went slower, made more mm-hmm. frequent stops. The other one, it was just like, where's the lions?
Yeah. That's it's funny you mentioned that. Like, so when I was in grad school, I did wildlife management plan for box turtles, right? So I'm much more of a herper than I am a birder. Mm-hmm. And one of my roommates was he did his study on malaria and St. Louis encephalitis in, what are they? Some sort of bird. And he's going to kill me for not knowing or remembering what it is. It starts with a P, it's yellow. It'll come to me like 3 days later. So, you know, it's funny because you're walking through the forest and he's looking up and I'm looking down, you know, it's just kind of how that relationship works, right? But it's a really interesting thing, you know, like talking about disease vectors, right? It's one of those things that I would love to explain to
Who
people.
Who doesn't talk about disease vectors?
Right, yeah. It's just, this is the thing that comes up in conversation every day. It's like, you know, what's really interesting is if there's less crows, you know, we get sick more, you know, isn't that neat? And, but it is true. It's like the corvids in particular do have basically our disease vectors, but they also are taking some of that disease away from people. It's one of those explanations where you're like, okay, if mosquitoes have disease and they're biting all kinds of things, the less they have to bite, the more likely they're going to bite us, right? And the more likely we are to get sick. And it's not quite that simple, but the amount of St. Louis encephalitis we see, for example, or West Nile, is directly related to those population dynamics. So really neat stuff. So I don't know, maybe we get a birder on here to get us into it. That's what we need.
Yeah. We heart birds.
Yeah. They're really, really intelligent.
Know more from someone who's an expert.
Yeah. They're intelligent animals. They are really unique animals. I love how smart crows are, for example. And if you ever want to see something on, you know, I'm sure there's something on YouTube about how they remember where they place objects. And
better memory than me.
Oh, yeah. Totally crush. Sure. That's so funny. Yeah. But yeah, really, really smart birds. Really, really neat. Yeah. All walks. And, you know, they've adapted everywhere. They breathe better than we do, which I think is also really fascinating.
What does that mean?
So it's much more efficient. The way that they breathe, they get a lot more oxygen out of the air than we do. So we just got these regular old mammal lungs, you know, holding us back. You know, but
I know, they got the good breathing and the good cold feet.
Yeah. Well, you think people always say, you know, like one of the actual
buoyancy. All these cool things.
I mean, they've got water resistant. Yeah. They could basically water repelling. So people always like the one thing that people have, right? As far as like natural adaptation is that we have a lot of stamina. We can run forever, not fast, but for a long period of time. So that's one of our actual perks and strengths. And then you compare that to like the Arctic tern, for example, which is the longest migration of any animal. It's like, you know, Antarctica to the Arctic, and it's like 12,000 miles, and it just straight up does it, you know? And we can't compare it to anything like that.
Yeah. I'm a huge fan of frigate birds.
Oh yeah. Yeah. The Galapagos, right?
No, they're everywhere. They pretty much, from what I understand, they live offshore for the most part. And then they come into shore with storms and stuff. So you see them, I probably don't see them often, but we see them in Florida, especially when there's storms around. So they'll come in with the storm. We were actually wakeboarding in Lake Tarpon in Florida, Tampa area once, and a storm was coming through and hundreds of frigate birds were circling above the lake and everyone else, no one cared. Everyone was just like, oh, bummer, rain delay. And I was like, oh my God, this is the coolest moment ever.
Right.
Because they were really low and, you know, you could see their 6 foot wingspan and it was just so like doomsday. I love just like super enthralled.
Right.
And everyone's like, what's wrong with her?
Yeah, right. Exactly. It's like, well, she's, you know, getting into science. And that's like one of the best parts of being like, you know, finding the natural world, like discovering it, right? Like when you find like your first baby turtle that's the size of a quarter or something like that, and you're like, this is neat, you know? And those moments are really fun. That's how you can tell like who's a scientist, you know, like where they're looking. You know, everybody else is like, oh, this stinks. And you're just staring up.
That's the plight and the wonderful thing about an organization like NAEP is like, you find your people, you know, all that time. That was like, I was early on in my, I think I was still even in school probably for biology. And I'm with people from sort of my old life, you know, and they're not necessarily people who cared anything about the environment, you know, so it's kind of singled out and alone in that space.
Yeah.
Now to be in a place where a lot of my connections and people I spend time with are also really enthusiastic and supportive. or just have the same type of values, I guess, you know, someone that would also be really in awe of a bunch of frigate birds circling overhead. Yeah. You know, it's really neat.
But it was like the difference between undergrad and grad school for me was undergrad, you're in a classroom of like 500 people and 10 of them care about why you're there. And then in grad school, you're like, oh, you guys all feel the same way as me. This is awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. And by the way, it's a prothonotary warbler. That was the bird. That's the bird.
Wow. I would never remember that.
They're very beautiful birds, by the way. You should look them up. They're really cute.
You are listening to EPR.
Hello and welcome back to EPR. We're joined today by Rona Spellacy, which I think I'm saying correctly. She is our vice president of NAEP, and she's also a senior environmental project manager at HDR. So I don't know, Rona, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and how you got into the industry?
Sure. Well, thanks for having me. This is really exciting to be on the inaugural or one of the inaugural versions of the podcast.
That's awesome to have you here.
Yeah, it really is.
So I'm Rona Spellacy. I am not particular how you pronounce my name, so please don't ever be concerned about that. As as you said, Nic, I am a senior environmental planner and project manager with HDR. We're a full service engineering consulting firm, and I'm based in Seattle, Washington. I've been with HDR for just over 17 years now, and I've done a variety of things and really run the gamut of all types of environmental review of a wide variety of infrastructure projects and planning projects.
Right.
So I've been there. I lead a team of scientists and planners at HDR, about 15 of us in Washington.
Nice.
And I'm also the Northwest Region lead for environmental science and planning at HDR. And at NAEP, I have been on the board of directors for 4 years now. I've been involved for most of my career in a variety of ways. And until recently, I was chair of our permanent conference committee, which kind of oversees the planning of our annual conference. And I'm also serving currently as vice president of NAEP.
Awesome. Yeah.
You did an awesome job as the PCC,
gosh.
By the way.
Thanks.
If we do say so, right. Yeah. But yeah, you have a lot of certifications after your name. There's just an incredible amount of acronyms, right? PMP, CEP.
I love the letters. I collect the letters. Yeah.
So, I mean, I want to know a little bit about how, like, why you pursue those and how they've helped your career.
Sure. So I have currently 3 certifications. I just recently got another one at 17 years in my career. So that's kind of fun.
Yeah.
So I hold the AICP, American Institute of Certified Planners, which is the certification associated with American Planning Association.
Right.
That was the first one I got right out of graduate school kind of as soon as I was qualified to get a certification. Mm-hmm. I felt like it was important to kind of justify that I was ready to go, that I was ready to, you know, go out there and do my job, so to speak. So that was a long time ago. Then probably several years ago, I would say 2008-ish or so, I got my CEP, which is Certified Environmental Professional. And that is through the ABSEP, American Board of Certified Environmental Professionals, which it's kind of a sister organization with NAEP. And again, just provides certification of excellence in the environmental profession. So AICP is a bit more broad in scope and applies to a lot of different types of planning. And so the reason I went with to try and get my CEP is to demonstrate that specialization in environmental planning in particular. And it has a pretty high threshold, in my opinion, for years of experience and you have to demonstrate a level of professional charge, so to speak, that you are the person leading the work. So I felt like it was important to demonstrate that with that certification.
But they do have an in-training, don't they? Just, you know,
they do.
They have, who may be just starting their careers. They do have an in-training, right?
They do. CEP in-training, which I think is an awesome opportunity. I actually didn't take advantage of it myself, but I have worked with many folks who have done the CEP IT, and it gives you an opportunity to develop a mentor relationship with a CEP so they can kind of help you and guide you through the process to get that certification. So it's really great. It's a great point. And then this past year, I was bored during the pandemic and feeling really frustrated that I wasn't able to go to conferences and, you know, continue my education and continue refreshing my skills. And so I was kind of searching for something to do that I could do from home. And I decided to get my PMP certification, which is a professional project manager, or I guess, what is it? Project management professional, PMP.
Yes, right.
So that was the last several years of my career. I've been engaged in more and more project management at a higher level with larger projects and, you know, more complex teams. And so it was really a great opportunity to kind of hone those project management skills and fill in the gaps that I had not learned along the way. Kind of doing it on my own. So it was great.
Yeah. And it's funny, you touched on something. It's really neat, like the shift in career, right? Like, so you started, you're doing a lot more the technical stuff, and then you've grown into this project management role. Like, how have you kind of navigated that? Because I know those are two different things.
They are different. I mean, and as my career has progressed, I've frankly gotten away from, you know, I continue to get away from the actual technical work of doing the analyses and do more and more of managing teams that conduct the analyses. So you still have that foundational understanding, but frankly, the tools have changed and the way those analyses are done changes over time. And at some point in your career, it's tough to keep up on those things if you're not doing the actual analyses yourself. So you have, in my opinion, the way I've dealt with that, I've tried to really just embrace that. And if I'm moving on from those skill sets, then I just want to make sure that I'm building new skill sets that are still bringing value. Yeah. And so that's why I've tried to, like I said, kind of hone those project management skills, because that's the way I can bring value to those projects now in my current role.
Right. Yeah. Which is great. And it's a great answer. So, and I think one of the other things that we haven't really spent a lot of time on is, you know, different types of NEPA. We talk about NEPA being this thing, you know, it's NEPA, it's there, but there are, you know, each agency handles it a little differently. And even each project is a little bit different. It's one of the things I love about it is there's no two projects that are the same. So I don't know, do you have any unique experiences that you've seen, maybe a unique project or something along those lines where it's NEPA, but it's different than what people would expect?
Ooh, I'll have to think about that for a moment. I would say I completely agree. NEPA is, you know, the framework, but each agency handles it sometimes entirely differently from one agency to the next. And to the next, we certainly have people within my firm and people I've encountered at NAEP who are very highly specialized. I do NEPA for this agency, and I know everything about how NEPA is done at this particular agency.
Right.
I personally struggle with specializing. I'm more of a generalist and I want a variety. So I would not say that I'm an expert in any particular NEPA process of a particular agency, because I like to work on a lot of different types of projects. Did not answer your question at all.
Well, maybe you can frame it this way. Like, is there something, you're based out of Seattle, right? And so maybe there's a challenge in the Northwest or in where you work that's different than it would be in other parts of the country, something like, you know.
Well, in Washington State, we actually have a State Environmental Policy Act referred to as SEPA. And, you know, not every state has this. I think many people are familiar with CEQA, which is the California version. CEQA, I find, is quite different than NEPA, but ours in Washington is pretty similar to NEPA, but it's managed by, or the, you know, kind of the SEPA rules are coming from a state agency, the Washington Department of Ecology, and they're, how shall I say this delicately, open to interpretation, let's say.
right.
They are slightly vague. And so there are some real challenges there. Not that NEPA doesn't have certain points that are vague, for sure.
Right.
But there are certain challenges there just because there's not as much precedent as there is with NEPA. So there's not as much ability to effectively interpret those rules for your project and understand what the implications are in terms of potential legal challenge and that kind of thing. So I would say that's a unique thing that we deal with here. We actually do a lot more SEPA projects than NEPA in my team.
Right. Okay.
They just come up more frequently.
Yeah. Well, I guess that does make some sense. Yeah. You know, we love to ask stories about fun project stories and things that happen. And you mentioned to us that there was a bridge that had to be built in a very specific way. What was that?
Yeah, so the State 520 bridge here in Washington was replaced. Mm-hmm. At the time, it was the largest, most expensive bridge program in the United States when it was being constructed. So it was a big deal. And I was just one of many, 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 many people that were involved in the environmental review and also the kind of ongoing evaluation and implementation of environmental commitments that came out of the review process. So during construction, we were constantly going through these hundreds of environmental commitments that were made during the review process and making sure that they were being implemented on the ground.
Right.
And one particular thing that came up during construction. So the bridge is a floating bridge. It floats on a series of pontoons. And the new design for the bridge included these wells in the pontoons on either end that were open to the water below. And this was to help with stormwater drainage off the bridge. So there's basically a hole in either end of the pontoon where it turns out birds would dive in to the well because they're like, oh, sweet, there's a little swimming pool for me here.
Yeah.
In particular, these cormorants that are very common in the area on Lake Washington where the bridge is, these delightful cormorants would dive into the well looking for fish. And then they would struggle to take off again because they need cormorants in particular, I guess. I'm not an ornithologist, but I've learned a lot about cormorants. They need a certain amount of, you know, distance to be able to get loft to take off. And the well was too small, so they were struggling to get out. Now, cormorants are not an endangered species, certainly not in the local area. Right. But, you know, nonetheless, migratory bird.
Adorable.
Yeah, yeah.
They are adorable. They're one of my favorite little creatures in the Seattle area. See them all like always like kind of airing out their wings on files.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, it's always a face they make too. Yeah.
Yeah. So Migratory Bird Species Treaty Act. Again, I'm not a bird person. I forget the exact acronym, but
MBT.
You have to take care of cormorants, even though they're not special. They're not bald eagles. They're not endangered. They're still important. So trying to explain this to the construction, the contractor, why they needed to care about these cormorants, which were literally everywhere. They're like, I don't understand. So nonetheless, we had to do something to help the cormorants. And so the solution that the engineers came up with was to build a ramp that went down into the well so the birds could walk out if they were trapped.
They
could just walk up this ramp. And of course, we immediately dubbed these the Cormoramps. because how could you not? And then there was, you know, a variety of implications to this. At first, the cost of the cormoramps was gazillion dollars because the bridge engineers said, well, if we're going to put a ramp in there, then some human might decide to walk on it, which means it has to be structurally sound to hold that much weight, even though the intent is for a bird to walk up the ramp. But we were able to navigate that issue. So finally, the ramps were installed. And the agencies involved said, okay, great. Show us that the birds are using these ramps and they're not perishing in the well. Well, we couldn't actually find any way to document that these birds were using the ramps. And then one time the construction manager said, okay, I've got a video of a cormorant using the cormoramp. Right. And so he sent us this video and there's a cormorant just standing on the ramp. It's just kind of standing there looking around.
Yeah.
And then in the very bottom left corner of the video, you see this stick kind of poking out of the corner. So there's a guy, I'm assuming, there's a guy at the bottom of the well, like gently encouraging the cormorant to take advantage of the very expensive ramp that we've built for him. And eventually he decides to waddle up the ramp and case closed.
Hey.
The moral of the story is, people ask why a bridge costs so much to build. And this is just one of many reasons, many examples of things you wouldn't think that are necessary.
Yeah.
But they turn out to be.
Well, I mean, you say the bridge was on pontoons, which just the sound, like that sounds terrifying to me. So
Well, it was a pretty big deal. Probably be a whole other episode to talk about that project. But it was, you know, billions of dollars. And a feat of engineering and the alternatives. So the original bridge that had been replaced was also built on pontoons. And the alternatives analysis for this project, I think they got to alternative AA because, or maybe BB, because they'd already gone through the alphabet on these alternatives.
Wow.
They looked at everything. They looked at a tram. They looked at, you know, ferry service. They looked at every possible way to construct this bridge in this location that would not involve floating on a pontoon. And they ended up essentially with the same design that was there before, because it was the best engineering solution for the location. This lake is hundreds of feet deep where this bridge is located. And so there's no way to build structure underneath it effectively. Yeah, yeah. And so, I mean, they spent years and a lot of energy really trying to make sure they had the best alternative. And they ended up with the same design that had been put in the 50s. It's kind of amazing.
Wow. Yeah, that is. That's really wild. And
it's a great project.
You just need a better Cormoramp.
Yeah,
we should try and find someone smarter than me to do an episode about that project, because it was just incredible. And it's still not done, but the bridge itself is complete, but there are approaches that are still under construction.
Yeah. Well, I mean, this is going to be our first podcast tease right there. You know,
there you go.
We'll put that on a later episode.
I was very, very fortunate and grateful to have an opportunity to work on that project. It really, really helped kind of shape my career and help me understand how I can fit into such a large team.
Yeah. And that's a great point. I think a lot of people have that moment, you know, where there's a project or a system or something that kind of propels you forward a bit. So it's great to hear that. And a couple other things we wanted to talk to you about. You know, you're in good company with people that love to travel. Like Laura and I both, I think, have a, you know, desire to see all 50 states and, you know, 7 continents. And it doesn't count unless you stand on Antarctica. That's the, you know, you have to be on, not the islands. You have to go to the actual. So I'm not going to ask you what your favorite trip was or your favorite place to visit. That's impossible. It's just an impossible thing to answer. So I don't know. Do you have a fun travel story? I mean, we're reminiscing because we're obviously not going anywhere now, but it's just one of those things that's the only thing getting me through is like, oh, remember that time I went to Alaska? That was cool, you know, or whatever it was. And I don't know.
Interesting. I have a lot of great travel stories. I'll try and think of one that doesn't involve, you know, drinking or partying. I guess one thing that happened not too long ago on a trip was I started kind of finding connections from one trip to another, even if I was in a very diverse or, you know, different part of the world.
Yeah.
A few years ago, I went to Eastern Europe and we were in Romania, specifically Romania, Hungary, those types of countries. But I remember going to dinner one of the first nights in Romania. In this part of the world, in Eastern Europe, there's a lot of really salty pork accompanied by really bland starches like polenta. Like there's this, that's how they eat, you know? Right. And I mean, I love pork, so it's fine. But if you just eat the pork, it's like a salt bomb. So you have to have this really bland starch with it. And if you just eat the starch, it's disgusting, right? There's no seasoning in it.
Nothing else. Yeah.
So you got to do it all together. And I remember having this moment of clarity where I'm eating this and I'm thinking about Hawaii and poi and how the first time I tried that, I was like, what would make you eat this? I don't understand why anybody would eat this, but I wasn't having it, you know, once I had it with the salty meat, the salty pork or, you know, whatever it was, then it made sense. And I thought, isn't that incredible to think about the same solution coming up in two entirely different cultures, two entirely different geographies, and yet it's the same idea, right?
Yeah.
And it just makes it feel to me like the world is so small and you really can find connections with these other cultures. And that is my favorite thing about traveling.
Yeah.
So that's an example.
No, it's a great example. Too good, actually. So we're going to go all the way. No.
Or if you think about like pierogies and empanadas and these things that like appear in every culture, every culture has like a pastry pocket, like a hot pocket.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep. Samosas.
So samosas. That's, I mean, obviously food is part of why I like to travel. I think you can tell, but
food and beer. Yes. Yes.
Yeah. That's right. But I love that connection that I made of like these cultures that are so different, but there's a linkage.
Yeah. There. And man. Okay. So a lot of follow-ups. So you said, you know, food and travel is another thing for me that's really, I really love doing. And there's a couple of challenges, I think, for that. And one of them is just my face, right? There's something about my face that says like, you know, okay, you say you want to try the local food, but we can see you, we're going to give you the bland version. And I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like going to Thailand and then everything we had, there was nothing. I was like, I like spicy food. And they're like, okay. but so it was a really challenge for me.
Can you do Thai hot?
I can't do Tie-Hot. There is a level that's too high for me. Tie-Hot is too high. And I remember in my younger days being foolish enough to think that I could handle it. No. But I'm like a step down from that. It's just when everyone sees me, they don't give me the step down. They give me like, you know, like the no seasoning at all. And so it's a challenge for me, like trying to find. And so I don't know how you find, how do you get that authentic cultural experience with food? Is there a trick that you found that helps you or no?
That's tough. I still struggle with that as well. Not so much that they just look at me and assume that I can't handle it, but because I'm going on like guided tours and,
yeah,
you know, it's a little bit sanitized for
right.
American palates. I did have some pretty spicy food on my, the last real trip I went on, ironically, was to China right before the pandemic. I did not cause the pandemic, just a disclaimer. I was home before right. it arrived here, but right. I got some spicy food, even though it was, you know, Americanized. We were on that trip to China and we were on a guided trip. You know, there were like 40, a group of 40 traveling together, and we're a couple nights on our own. And this couple told me that they booked like a foodie tour through a local group that took them to like the street vendors went around. And so, cause for me as a, you know, I love to travel, but I'm not so adventurous. I'm a little afraid of the food poisoning and those kind of things.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
just sure. going out into the market myself is intimidating, but going with a local guide, just the two of them, I thought that was such a great idea. So I think there are so many options like that now available online because of our amazing globalization and our amazing ability to find resources like that online these days. I will definitely try that the next time I get to travel, whenever that is.
Yeah, right.
But yeah, I don't know that I have a great answer besides that.
No, that's still is really good. It is. And you know,
that's a great answer. Actually, getting a local guide is a perfect example of that.
Which is something like even maybe 10 years ago, we would never, how would you do that?
Right.
But now there are websites and you can go find this opportunity. So I think it's great.
Yeah. And you mentioned like your love of food and travel, and you bring that back with you, right? Like sometimes you'll take that inspiration and cook it yourself. Is that something you
do? Not well, but, but I did, when I got back from China, I definitely went on a Chinese cooking spree because I was just so fascinated. In America, you know, we're so familiar with Japanese and Thai food cuisine that are not all that different from what you would get in those countries.
Right.
But I think American Chinese food is not what you get when you go to China. Even though we were on this very American style tour, we definitely experienced some things that I had never tasted that were just amazing. So I did go on a little bit of a spree when I got home, just kind of learning the flavors and the kind of key ingredients. I feel like every time I do this, I go on a trip and then I buy a cookbook and I notice that like every recipe has the same six spices and then they put, you know, one new thing in it or cook it in a slightly different way. That's so funny. It's just a matter of kind of, or that's what I enjoy is trying to understand like, why does that taste amazing? Oh, it's this ingredient. So, but I do not claim to be an expert.
Yeah. So it's I'm just hearing dinner at Rona's house. That's what I'm hearing. So,
I do like to cook for people as well.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
I'll try and practice a couple times before that though.
Yeah. Right.
I won't experiment on you.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, either way, there's always an experience there's always a story to tell, right? No matter what, either it's, you know, oh, wow, we had this great dinner, or you would not believe what I just ate.
Yeah. We had to order pizza after it was not.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. The kids were crying. There was, you know, it's all kinds of, yeah. I think Laura, you had a question.
Yeah. I wanted to, before we let Rona go, I want to ask about your involvement with NAEP and especially now as being vice president. What was your expectation when you joined and now that you've been with them so long, and what did you expect for 2020 and how we had to change? And, you know, what's just your experience been like?
Oh my goodness. That's a big one. I've been involved in NAEP since the start of my career in 2003-ish. You know, again, my attempt to, okay, I'm a planner now. I'm doing environmental stuff.
Right.
What organization does that? And so I found NAEP and the Northwest chapter of NAEP. So I've been involved in a variety of ways over the many years of my career. I remember when I first attended a conference, the annual conference, and being so intimidated by, you know, these people like Grishmael was the keynote speaker when he was, you know, at CEQ still, and I probably butchered his name, so apologies for but I remember seeing him on the stage and thinking, oh my gosh, I can't believe I'm in the presence of this person. Like, I'm so intimidated by him. And 10 years later, I was, you know, sitting at breakfast at the plenary session next to Horst and having like a normal conversation with him. And, you know, for me, NAEP is almost a family, and it's a small organization. You know, we're not as big as some of the big professional associations, but for me, I actually cherish that because I love getting to know everybody that is really engaged in the organization, like Horst and like Ted Bowling, getting to know him over these past few years through being on the board and organizing his participation in our conference, and just getting to know these people who are shaping our profession. Really, they're directly involved in shaping the policies that we implement every day in our job, and having access to them and being able to really engage with them and understand where they're coming from is just very unique and special. And so that's an example of my evolution at NAEP. I've had a lot of different roles, but at this point it feels, you know, I've been involved so long, it feels like part of my family.
Yeah.
Awesome. I like being part of your family.
I like you being part of my family, both of you.
Yay. All right.
PR, EPR love hour.
There's a few crazy uncles in there, but you know, I'll take the bad with the good.
Always. Do you have anything else you want to share with us before we head out, where people can find you, anything you're working on?
Oh gosh. Well, I just actually vacated my role as chair of the permanent conference committee. So I will make a plug for the annual conference coming up in May. This will be our second virtual conference. We had to pivot last year, which I didn't really answer your question about. What was I expecting in 2020? I was expecting to go to a conference in Florida.
And, me too.
Yeah.
That would have been amazing. And we didn't get to do that. And so we had to pivot at the last minute and present a virtual conference for the first time ever. I mean, none of us knew what we were doing or getting into. And I think it was a great success and a great opportunity for people to try and stay connected during the pandemic. So now we've done one, we're pros, right? So the next virtual conference in May will, I think, be even better. And I would just really encourage people to register for that conference and get engaged. The call for abstracts just got extended, so you can still participate and submit an abstract for that. I think that right now, more than ever, I think it's important for us all to try and connect and, you know, really make sure that we're staying engaged with each other and with our profession and understanding the latest and greatest news in environmental planning and review. We have, you know, a new administration coming in. There's been so many questions circulating about how that will impact us as environmental professionals. And we are making every effort to provide the latest and greatest information to our members, not only through the conference, but with our webinars and NEPA training workshops and all of these things. That is our mission, is to get that information out to our members and everyone involved in the environmental profession. So that's my plug for the conference and for our other educational opportunities. I'm very much looking forward to getting together in person at a conference again in the near future. But in the meantime, I'm just grateful to have opportunities to engage with everybody in our little family at NAEP, including this podcast. So thank you so much for hosting.
Yeah, thank you so much for joining us today. It's good to see your face.
A lot of fun.
I'm glad I can.
Y'all can't see my face, but just let me tell you, it's awesome.
It is. You look fantastic. Really great talking to you. Thanks for being here. Thanks for all you do for NAEP. We will catch you in Fort Lauderdale one day on the beach soon. I can't wait.
Fort Lauderdale 2022.
All right, we'll do it.
But meanwhile, attend the virtual conference this year. Thank you guys so much for having me. It's been a pleasure. And thank you for all you do for NAEP.
Thank you. Thanks, Rona.
Thanks, Rona.
All right. That's our show. Thanks, Rona, for being here. Thanks for tuning in. Be sure to check us out on Fridays is when we release these. And when you do that, subscribe, rate, and give us a nice review. We'll catch you next time.
See you, everybody.